Assalamualaikum. This is CJ.
Waalaikum salam. Yes. Go ahead, yes.
Go ahead.
Yes, how old were you when you accepted Islam and what year was it? Do you remember?
When I finally accepted Islam, I was 18. 19.
No, you remember the
18,
year?
1999.
Yeah. Who introduced you to Islam?
Rap music. It's for real, seriously. It's rap music.
Why you chose to accept Islam, though? What was the reason behind it? Like,
I don't know. Like, I got introduced to Islam when I was in the fifth grade. So when I first started listening to rap music, so there was like all these rappers.
What rappers you talking about? Okay.
Rakim.
Because you was talking about Poor Righteous Teachers or something.
Poor Righteous Teachers, all them. Big Daddy Kane. I looked up to all Brandubian. Now, I didn't know that they wasn't Muslim. Well, I wouldn't say they wasn't Muslim, but they thought they were Muslim. I thought that was Islam. So I grew up listening to that stuff. I was big, like this in the late 80s, early 90s. So I had read about Malcolm X.
By any means, that's right.
Yeah, so when I would listen to the music and they were talking the same stuff that Malcolm was like, that was a big thing in the 80s, the late 80s and 90s. So like X-Clan and KRS-One, all of them, they talked about, you know, Islam.
So rap got a connection with you accepting Islam.
Yeah. So I was introduced by them, but I was in the sixth grade when I had to teach. You know, I used to go to Catholic school. I used to go to St. Peter's Catholic school. And our teacher, my sixth grade teacher, her name was Mrs. Fletcher. And we had to study like world religions and stuff. So we talked about Buddhism, we talked about Christianity. Well, of course, we was at a Catholic school, but we talked about different branches of Christianity, like Baptist and Pentecostal. And so when we got to the section on Islam, we did a real long, I actually learned the Sirah of the Prophet Islam in the sixth grade.
In Catholicism?
Yeah, when I was in Catholic school, I learned. And the only difference was, like, back then the teacher told me that it wasn't true. She said his story wasn't true. So that's probably what really caught my interest, because his story, like, I used to get a grade in religion, like, in sixth grade. So I had to learn the story of Jesus Christ, like, over and over again. So when I first got introduced to the story of the Prophet, his story resembled Prophet Jesus, and I didn't, like, I was asking my teacher, like, yo, why, like, their story is very similar, and she said, yeah, but it's not true.
So why even say it then, right? Why even mention it?
We had to learn.
Oh, okay. Right.
It was one of them things, like, you know, when you get to a certain age, they want you to know about other cultures and other religions.
Right.
Just because it was a Catholic school, they told me it wasn't true. Now that I'm older, so I went sixth grade learning that's the, you know, the Sirah, but she told me it wasn't true. And it wasn't until I got out of high school. So my first year out of high school is when I accepted Islam. But from sixth grade to then, I just studied, you know, I studied different things.
Mm-hmm.
And I went back to church and I tried to get, like my family grew, like I kind of grew up going to church, but my family isn't really religious. But when I was in high school, I tried to get ingratiated with the church again. So I tried, and I remember I used to go to church. And now, you ever go to church?
Mm-hmm. Right? Yeah, so I come from the same background. Yeah,
we would go to church, and they would say, all right, now bow your head and pray, right? And be silent. So put your head down and go pray.
Right.
And I'm really praying, like, hard, like, God, please do this and give me that, whatever it was. And then halfway through your first prayer, then you start hearing the organs. It's like, dun, dun, dun. And then it's like, damn, these niggas is trying to guide my prayer. That's how I felt. Like, why are you guiding me? Like, let me pray to God on my own. And I didn't like that. And so that's one of the things that made me go back to studying Islam again, or just being interested. And then another thing, I was working in a barbershop, and you know Mikhail.
Right,
Growing up, he was the Muslim he was the first real Muslim. Yeah, like before I used to know people in the Nation of Islam and people, you know, there were like 5% of the people as part of the
I come from that era. I know what you're talking about.
York. So I didn't know. I thought that was his thing. So when I started working in a barbershop, this is in high school, I met Mikhail, I met Brother Tyler Dean, I met, I worked for Tyler, I met Hadi. So all these different Muslims that were like real Sunni Muslims, I met, and I, you know, they were very impressionable. You know, impression on me. So that's, I tried going to church again, and then that praying situation, that's what made me say, you know, I'm going to start learning the same again. Because I was around them. And they were good brothers who, like, you know, they
represented Islam well.
Yeah, they did. I mean, for what I thought of it.
All right, you know? So, how, from you being around that, right, you accepting Islam, how has Islam changed your life? Like, what's some of the things you altered from being previously to accepting Islam? Or do you notice a change?
Yeah, big change. I didn't, when I was Christian, like most Christians, I thought that, you know, my belief was things that you do. You ever hear people, they say,
yeah, acts. Like,
yeah, they think your acts are your belief. And it's, I understand now, being a Muslim, and, you know, learning fiqh taught me that too. Because when I first took shahada, I didn't learn fiqh maybe until like 7-8 years later, or 6 years later. So, but knowing that my belief and my actions have to represent my beliefs and not the other way around.
Right.
As a Christian, I used to, you know, people say, oh, Christians do X, Y, and Z. Muslims do. It's not about what you do. It's about what you believe in your heart first. So that's Aikido. So if I learned Aikido properly, and then I learned that my actions, how I pray, or, you know, what I do, what I don't do, is all based on my belief first. So when I was a Christian, I used to just think that everything was, oh, you can't do this, you can't do that, in whatever religion it is. And most, I think most people, they look at religion like that. Like, you ever hear people say, I'll never be a Muslim because, you know, I like to eat pork, or I can't, I don't want to pray 5 times a day. It's like, they always look at the things that,
the rules, yeah.
The rules, and it's not about the rules. And I've learned, I mean, it is about the rules, but it's not, that's not the most important thing. The most important thing is your belief first. And so, like, what changed my life, back to original question, is, you know, having children, like, as I wasn't raised Muslim. So now my children, you know, they both have different experiences, but like my son, for instance, he was raised in Islam, and I didn't really beat him down with Islam, but he's raised around it, and to watch him at his age to choose to be a Muslim, like, he could choose to not do any of these things, but he chooses to do so because of his belief. So that's like a, you know, that's a big life change for me, because I didn't think that that would ever happen. And then, you know, people talk to you and they say, all right, well, you don't have to do that. Nobody's making you, you know. And it's like, nah, I'm choosing to do this because of my belief. And I'm happy to do some of the things. Some things I struggle with, but, you know, for the most part, like, this is my way of life. And then that's the difference between when I was a Christian. I was never Catholic, but I was probably Baptist. But even being in the Baptist church, being in Catholic schools, my mother is a minister too. So, you know, my mom is very close to me, and all these things influenced me. But I never did any of those things because I was choosing to. It was more like, you know,
you feel like it was forced on you?
Not that it was forced, but you just grow, like, almost like a tradition. Like, we do these things out of tradition.
Ritualistic, you mean?
Exactly. Like, you know, when I first started studying the Islam in high school, like, really studying it, I somebody showed me one time, said, yo, you know, our people weren't Christians in slavery. Like,
right.
Christianity was,
well, Alex Haley proved that in his book, Roots.
Yeah, and I didn't know that until, like, I didn't see Roots until I was in high school. So then when, you know, you read these things, I read the autobiography of Malcolm X, all those things had, like, an effect on me. And I said, oh, well, do I, not that I felt like I was brainwashed or anything, but you had to look at, like, all right, do I do these things because I want to do them mm-hmm. or because it's just what the tradition is in my family. And when I asked my family, I learned that that's what my family just did out of tradition. They didn't really...
And they didn't question it.
Yeah, they never questioned it. It was mm-hmm. just, this is what we do. And when yeah. I asked why, it's like, this is what we do. Like, we go to church. And we,
yeah.
You know, we do Christmas. And that used to confuse me, too, because I come from a family, and I'm not trying to say nothing bad about my family, but my family isn't, like, they're not really super religious Christians either. So they're the kind of people who... And they're good people. Like, I'm not bashing them or nothing, but, you know, they drink and go to church and...
Yeah.
Out and like most people do. So like, we're balanced, but they don't think it's okay. When I became a Muslim and I learned, like, our Muslims we sin too, and I might do something that I ain't got no business doing, but I'm going to repent. And Allah is looking for me to repent and asking for forgiveness. Mm-hmm. And I never really knew. I would read about repentance when I was going to Catholic school, but I never knew. And we know about everybody. Like, I wasn't ever taught how to repent.
Oh, yeah.
You see what I'm
right.
saying? Like, we just...
There wasn't a form of it.
There was no form. And even, like, when I first took Shahada, I didn't... I mean, I wanted to be a Muslim because I wanted, like, these people I looked up to, I wanted to be like them. Like, I met Muslim men who were just, at the time, I thought were, like, very, they had very exemplary character.
Yeah, that's the same thing I remember, man.
But I didn't know... I didn't understand, like, why I had to pray, or why I had to pray in Arabic, mm-hmm. or why five times. And I would ask questions, and people didn't really have answers. So, you know, the ritualistic part of Islam, I didn't understand why. But once I learned why, it's like, oh, hey, Allah is deserving of that. Makes sense. So it's not just, all right, we believe. Like, I have friends who are, like, Christian or other religions and stuff, and they said, well, how come you have to pray? You know, why you got to get up in the morning? Why you got to fast and all? You don't have to do that. You believe in God. You be a good person. And it's like, I have to because, like, look at all the things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does for me. Doesn't he deserve that mm-hmm. back, you know? And that connects with mm-hmm. me. And I never saw, now not that the state of Christians don't have that, because I know there are some Christians who think that way. Like, I think my mom thinks that way. Like, very much so, but I don't know a lot of them. A lot of the Christianity that I studied, and it was more so about the feeling, you know what I mean? And it was all like, hey, you do this, you're gonna feel better, or you know, you go drink, have this holy water, they're gonna splash on your head, you'll feel better. I'm gonna hit you in the head, you're gonna fall out, you're gonna feel better. Like, it was all feelings, and not to say that stuff doesn't happen or doesn't work. But I wasn't just looking for a feeling. I wanted correct belief, too.
Yeah.
So the idea that 1 + 1 + 1 = 1, that didn't make sense to me. I never understood that, you know? So, you know.
All right, so what story in Islam you think touches you the most? Like, what's the most, the one that had an impact on you the most? It could be from the Sirah, the Quran, anything. You like the system of fiqh?
Oh, yeah, I love fiqh.
You know what I'm saying? So what's what grabs you the most?
Oh, what grabs me the most?
Yeah.
Fiqh does it for me.
Why fiqh, though? Why the Islamic jurisprudence? Why that?
Because I'm a logic guy. So everything is... For me, I like organization. And everything is X's and O's for me. So I don't do things just based off my feelings. You know what I mean? So fiqh does it for me. Because then... If you explain the rules to me of a game, then I'll figure out how I can play within those rules.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so that's what I like about studying fiqh. But tasawwuf too, like I love tasawwuf, but you know, that's not something that I don't think people ever master. But something like fiqh, like you can learn fiqh and then...
Why do you think the tasawwuf, the spirituality part, why do you think, what do you mean, many people haven't mastered it?
Well, I don't know some people that do, but many people don't, because, I mean, this is like psychology. You're against yourself. You're learning about yourself, and that's an ongoing thing.
Right.
That's not one of those things that you ever conquer. Not to say that you conquer fit, but it's... You know, that's an ongoing self-improvement.
Oh, yeah, that's a process as time, with Islam. It's like levels.
Yeah. there's levels to it.
Yeah.
But as far as stories, of course the story of the prophets of Islam. Like, I love this
Yeah,
story.
But like in that story, right, in his life, is it one particular story that sticks out to you? Like, man, that's a beautiful event that took place. Or the prophet said something, did something that really.
All right, so I'll give you an example, right? I mean, of course, all the stories.
I know.
When I went on Umrah, when I went on Umrah 2 years ago, and the brother who was taking me out, the Battle of Uhud, right?
Yeah.
When you actually go to the sites,
mm-hmm.
that's what connected me to everything. And I mean, I've been Muslim for over 17 years, 2 years ago, you know what I mean? But actually going there and him showing me, hey, this is the maqam of so-and-so. And so, like, I'm like, wow. So when he took me up into Mount Uhud, so he takes me up there and he says, and I put pictures of this on my Facebook, but showing me the actual place where the Prophet put his face and his hands and hugged Mount Uhud. And when you read in the Sirah, they talk about how the mm-hmm. mountain hugged him back.
Right.
And I got to go to the place. Like, I went right there, put my face where his face was, and he said, this really happened. And, like, stuff like that, that's what, like, connects me to this and really warms my heart. Because sometimes you being in this world and in this country and in our society, and you kind of forget that this stuff is real. Like, sometimes you'll be reading something.
Think it's a fairy tale.
It's almost like a fairy tale. Yeah. You go and you actually see, like, all right, one story I'll give you, right? You know how we always read in Hadith how Prophet Isa is going to come back and he fight
the Dajjal, right?
Fight the Dajjal, and that he's going to live a natural, like, he's going to live
the rest of his life out.
He's going to die a natural death, and he's going to ask to be buried next to the Prophet. Like, I've read that story 1,000 times, right? But then when I went on Umrah, we're in Medina, we're in the Prophet's Islam's masjid, and in his masjid, you know, the section of the Rawdah, right? Yeah, we go, and the guy that's showing me, he said, yeah, and here's where Rasulullah is buried, and here's where Abu Bakr and Siddiq is buried, and there's this spot right there that's for Isa alayhi salam. I'm like, what? I'm like, he said, yeah, that's where he's going to be when he does come. And I'm like, yo, I read that hadith, man, something to actually see it. It's like, yo, it's for real. Like, that's really going to happen.
Yeah.
You know, and you know, when you outside of the country and you're not actually seeing this stuff, it just sounds like a bunch of fairy tales.
Wow.
To go, you know, I mean, we went to, even though the graves aren't marked because, like, the government there.
Yeah, the Saudi government destroyed them.
Yeah, they destroyed it. But to go and they're like, look, this is where his uncle Hamza's buried, and this is where, you know, so-and-so. Like, I went to all those places, and then you're like, man, this ain't no fairy tale.
This is real stuff,
mm-hmm. and it really happened. And you know, it's a reminder to you. I like, if I could go every single year, I would, because you need the reminder, kind of like, to bring you back, you know, to earth, like, it grounds you.
All right. So, what areas of Islam do you think you need improvement on?
All of them. Literally, all of them. Everybody knows I need to bite my tongue. Oh,
what's some of the things, yeah, I said, by you being accepted Islam, me too, and a convert, what's some of the things that you think that should be instituted for new shahadas? Because,
because
if I do a talk, it's going to be long. But I would like to hear what you guys would say about that.
You already know, I think. I
because you got the same way I was.
And our people are messed up, bro.
Like, yeah.
We don't. I always have a soft spot for people who take shahada. Because when I took
my shahada, I do too.
You know, no. I remember I went to, there was a store in Atlantic City where they had, it was an Islamic store right next door to Master Taco. I used to be so excited to go, and I went. And the first time somebody sent me there, they said, in the barbershop, they told me, hey, you need to get Sahih Muslim by that set of hadith. I said, I didn't know what it was. So I went over there and I asked a brother to sell me Sahih Muslim. And he didn't just give me the book and take my money. He said, "Who told you to get this book?" And I said, "My brother in the barbershop." So then he said, "Who's your sheikh?" Right? And at the time, I'm a new shahid. I didn't know what a sheikh was. So I'm like, "My sheikh." So I named Brother Hadi, who was just the barber that worked next to me. And I was asking, "Hadi's my sheikh." I don't know. So he says, "All right." He's asking about my minhaj and all this crap. And I'm like, "Well, I don't know what that means. You know what I mean? Like, just give me the book, right?" So I got it. Like, I wish that stuff would stop. But, like, we live in a world where it's titles. And mm-hmm. It's just no holds barred. Because we don't have any
structure.
There's no structure. And I don't think we're ever going to have it.
Now, I'm going to tell you something, right? The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, for one, is a forgotten sunnah that he would never leave a new shahada just out there like that. It's when what it's called is mu'akha. Mu'akha meaning he would pair somebody up with another sahabi. Mm-hmm.
And use that in Medina.
Yeah, they usually would stay with them for a matter of time. That sunnah is gone. It's nowhere. They give somebody a shahada, give them a pamphlet and a kufi, and say, "Here you go." That's it.
And then here's the problem. A lot of people... The few people who are trying to...
Yeah, they work, sincere. They got that zeal.
They sincere, but one of the problems that we have, that sincere person, they don't know what they're doing.
Yeah.
So you end up passing on bad habits. So like that experience with me in that bookstore, I didn't go back to the masjid for a year, bro. Like it took me like a year, maybe a year and some change. I went home and I stayed on Google because I felt like I wanted to get myself together for the people in them. I didn't know. I wasn't even thinking about Allah at the time. It was like, man, I don't want nobody questioning me or laughing because I don't know. Like, I used to go on Google and I would look up terms. Like, what is... I didn't know. But people talk to you in Arabic. You don't know what the hell the word mean. And they calling you Habib. And I'm like, I don't know none of that stuff. I don't call me Habibi. Like, that was Habibi. Like, I don't know. And so just to get...
I think that stuff, you know, like, it's trend now. Like, now, before it was that. Before it was Habib, then it was, now it's Sheikh. Everybody's a Sheikh somehow. Yeah, which they not kind of, Sheikhs, but that's a term that they use. Then before that was Beloved, and then it was Saidi. Did they say Saidi now?
I had to look up all of that stuff. And this is like in 1999 and 2000. And I used to go to Master Taqwa when I first started going, the brother took me to Taqwa, and once I got there, I felt like, wow, this is good. I felt like brotherhood, and you know, I was all cool with people touching my feet and foot to foot. I'm like, oh, cool, this is great. But I was sitting in the khutbah, and the imam, he would do half the khutbah in English and the other half would all be Arabic, and I would sit there and not know what the heck he was talking about.
Yeah.
But I purposely didn't go to any of the other masjids because I didn't want to be around people that I knew because I just didn't want to feel uncomfortable.
Mm-hmm.
So, this brother, he's dead now. Forgive my sins. Brother James Sharif, that was my homie. I used to cut his hair. And when Master Muhammad first moved to Albany Avenue, he came to the barbershop and invited me. He said, "Oh, why are you going to the other masjid? Why don't you come over here? It's our people. You'll feel comfortable." And I was so scared to go there. And then the first time I went, like, I enjoyed it. Like, it was all in English, and I was able to understand what the man was talking about. And I still kind of, like, kept my distance from people because I didn't know them. But after a while, like, people made me feel comfortable, and then I got in there. And then probably after 2 years, then I thought they was all deviants because people... they corrupted me.
Yeah.
Like, you know what I mean? Like, once you get in and then people start talking and then they hear these people, they don't do this right and they don't do that and don't go to that masjid. And
you know, it's crazy because you new to Islam and then you get tainted with all these other...
You get flooded with all
these things. Yeah, and it's crazy.
And
you still don't know what's going on. Yeah, but they just tell you, stay away from this, stay away from that.
And so what happens to me, if somebody tell me to stay away from something, I'm going to go...
That's me. I'm the same way.
You know what I'm saying? So that's how I met you. So everybody said, don't go to the Dawah Center. Don't do this. All right, cool. I'm going to go over there. You know what I mean? I went there and I got you know, comfortable with everybody. And I had a rapport with somebody in probably every masjid after that. Yeah. And then I think in 05 is when I met Imam Amin. Mm. And then he kind of, you know, I don't want him to toot his horn, cause, you know, but he straightened out all that stuff for me.
Yeah.
That I was confused about with him. And then when I met the brothers from Philly, Hanif and Naeem and Khalil, like when I met them, that's when I really started like studying fiqh. And then once I got into it, once I learned the rules of everything, then that made it clear, because that's how I like structure. So
yeah.
If we're going to play a game, you explain, oh, we're going to play basketball. You sit me down, or it's Monopoly. Once I learn the rules, and I understand the rules, then I'm like, oh, I can do this, I can't do that. I can't do this, you can do this sometimes mm-hmm. you can't do this. And once I figured that out, then I went back and looked at everything that I had learned from the time that I did take shahada. I had to learn over. And then I understood it, like, all right, cool. And now I ain't saying like I'm a master at anything, but that's learning your fardhu ain. But mm-hmm. no one ever explained that to me in the mm-hmm. beginning. Like, yo, these are things that you have to learn as soon as you become a Muslim.
Yeah, like obligatory now.
Yeah, these are obligatory things. And then, mm-hmm. all right, you got that. Now I can navigate my way through life.
Yeah, right.
You know what I mean? So I wish that...
So by you saying that, so what's... if people listen to this, what's the first thing you suggest that they should do if they knew Shah?
They should every person needs a method. Mm. Like, hands down. Like, and one of my teachers...
I agree with you.
Yeah, my one of the teachers I learned from was brother Anas Muhammad, he's the imam at Kuba Masjid in Philly. And in one of the classes, he told me, he said, everybody has a method, even if you don't want one. Like, you have one.
Yeah.
And he said, you know, the Prophet said, Sam, he had a method. And everybody sat in the class, and, who was his teacher? Who made you get a man? He said, he learned from the Angel Jabril. That's his method. That was his teacher. That's his sheikh. And I said, oh, that makes sense. Now, I came up in a time where everybody was, yo, man, you don't take from these people. You don't blind follow. You don't do this. You don't do that. But once he said that to me, it made it clear to me. Like, oh.
Because you need a teacher.
Yeah, you do need one. You know what I mean? And so when I met Imam Amin, he's my teacher. And then later on, someone else became my teacher. But the teaching styles may vary, but the structure is all the same.
Yeah,
it doesn't matter
yeah.
what method. So I think, one, everybody needs a method. Two, everybody needs it. You know, you need a teacher to teach him method.
Yeah, this mm-hmm. whole idea of this self-being taught yeah. crap that mm-hmm. I can read books, and that's wrong.
Yeah.
That's not even traditional Islam. That's mm-hmm. them making something up.
Yeah, but then here's the crazy part to all of this. And this is, I learned this the hard way, like really the hard way, probably through like, you know, from people talking about me, through marriage, through all the hard mm-hmm. stuff that I went through. I learned the hard way. All of these things, all is all determined by taqwa first. Like fiqh, madhabs, your tasawwuf, none of that stuff exists without taqwa, because the reality is mm-hmm. you don't have to do none of this stuff. Like, there's nobody, like when I went on Umrah, and I never got, somebody, like, you know, everybody knows once the event gets called, everybody shuts the business down there.
Right? Yeah.
But there was one woman, I was walking through the mall, and her kimar came off by accident. And it was just an accident. She was just, I guess the tourist or whatever, came off. Everybody in the mall was like, and they did not just looking at her crazy, but rushing to get her chemo off the floor and help her put it back on.